Hello, this is the Provoked Prawn, and this is the Rog Strix 850-watt white power supply unit. And in this video, I'm going to be unboxing and installing this power supply, talking about the various highlights of it, what's included in the box, and showing you how to set it up. So if you want to know what cables you need to plug in where, and how they're used, and what they're connected to on both ends, then stick with me as I'm going to show you what's happening there and how to do it. Now, I built this in the NZXT H510 flow, along with a number of other things, and I'll leave the specs of the build in the description as well as links to the other videos in case you're curious. But what I wanted to demonstrate was the installation process and also some of the highlights of this. This power supply unit has a 10-year warranty on it, so it should last for quite some time. And 850 watts will be a nice amount of power for most PC builds. However, if you haven't purchased already, I would recommend using a power supply unit calculator to make sure that 850 watts is enough for your system, and I'll leave a link to that in the description. You can basically input all the things you need and work out what wattage you need for your computer before you build it. Make sure you have enough power to power it properly. Now, in the box, you obviously get the power supply unit and a whole lot of cables, and these can seem quite intimidating if you've not set up and built with a power supply unit before. And these are individually sleeved as well, so I found them a little bit fiddly, as I'll show you later on. And there's a lot of them. You don't necessarily need to plug them all in, and that's worth bearing in mind, and I'll show you why and talk about that a bit as we go through. And also, in addition to that, you get a number of other things, including some plastic cable ties, which I'm not actually going to be using in this build, and I'll talk about why later on, but I would recommend you do. And some very useful Velcro ties as well, which you can use. And there's a cable mod discount code there, which I haven't used, so knock yourself out if you want to buy some cable mod cables. There are extension cables that you can use that basically make your cabling look a bit nicer at the front of your case, and that might well be worth it, actually. And I'll show you why when I set this thing up. Now, the included manual doesn't really tell you very much, apart from the fact that you have a zero decibel option on the fan. You also get a little extra bit of good stuff in here, which you can customize the look of your power supply unit. So if you've got a case that allows you to sort of show off bits of it, then you can take advantage of these. So there's a number of stickers and also some magnet bits that you can stick on, basically stick to the side, and then a nice ROG logo that you can also apply. So if you want to do this, if you have a case where you have a little bit of a hole that you can see your power supply unit through, then these are beneficial. For me, it's going to be buried at the back of the PC, so it's completely pointless. But I just want to quickly demonstrate that in a second and show you what it looks like and where you can put them. So this is the power supply itself, obviously, in a nice little bag. And as you'll see, a very nice looking PSU. And it will look the part in a white build, assuming that you can see parts of it. Now, it's nicely labeled, as you can see here, and I'll show a close-up of that and talk about where you plug in each individual thing as we go through. You'll notice on the side that it has ROG logos on it, and there's also some what looks like venting on the side too. At the rear, there's a button to turn the zero decibel fan on and off, so you can basically set it so the fan doesn't run and keeps quiet if necessary. So you'll see here that there's some perforated holes around the edge there, and that's actually where you stick on the magnet thing. It doesn't seem very logical because it looks like you'd lose some heat there. I put mine on here, but that isn't actually what you're meant to do. You're meant to put them on the other way, so you could stick them on like this, for example, over those holes, and then you have the logo visible, and that's assuming that some of your PSU is visible through the case, which it may well not be, but an option to customize the look and feel of it. So a few different weird and wonderful highlights in this case. Frankly, I wish the cables were a bit nicer in place of things like this, because you'll see they're individually sleeved, but they're also a bit fiddly. So now I'm going to go through the cabling. So this is the 24-pin motherboard cable, the most important one. And you'll notice with all these cables, they're labeled PSU on one end and then whatever it is on the other end as well. So the PSU end goes into the power supply unit. This one is for the CPU cables, so that's essentially plugging in 8-pin connectors to other parts of your motherboard, and I'll show you where later on. PCIe goes in your graphics card or other peripherals, and there's multiple of these, actually three of these cables included in the box, so you've got plenty of cables to plug in, and you'll see that they're also sort of daisy chain, so you have them split into two parts, and I'll talk more about this later on as I go through, but you can see that there's looped at the end as well, so you can actually plug in two lots of 8 pins with relative ease there, but you can see there's three cables, so you've got plenty of power for large, power-hungry graphics cards as well, so that's pretty important, and it will become apparent that it varies quite a lot from GPU to GPU. This is the flat SATA power connector, and you'll see multiple connections coming off of one cable, which means that you can plug in multiple things. This is used for SSDs and hard disk drives and fan controllers and other things like that. Then you have Molex controller, and this is power for other peripherals and can be used for things like liquid cooling pumps. I've seen that on there previously. I'm not going to show footage for that in this video because most people won't use these cables. You don't usually need to worry about those cables. In most cases, you won't, but you will use the flat SATA ones quite probably. Here, a close up look at the bit where you connect up those cables, and you can see that it's marked motherboard, CPU, VGA, PCIe, SATA peripheral, IDE, and Molex as well. And some of them are interchangeable, so CPU and PCIe, for example, go in the same place. But the first and most important one is that motherboard cable. So the 24-pin motherboard power supply cable is one of the most important because that connects up to your motherboard and your PC won't boot without it. Again, they are marked PSU on one end, but in this case, the sort of long, fattest one is the bit that goes in the motherboard, and then the one that's split into two parts goes in the power supply, and you'll see you need to plug it in the bottom right where it's marked MB, MB for motherboard. And so there's plugs in there, and you can only plug it in one way because there's a little clip to hold it in place. You need to plug it in until it clicks, and then it's ready to go. This, for demonstration purposes, it plugs in the right hand side of the motherboard, and again there's a clip on it, so you can only plug it in one way. Obviously don't plug it in like this with the motherboard outside the case. I'm just doing this for demonstration purposes, and I will show a bit later on how they actually do it when it's installed. Now, the power supply unit CPU cables go in the bottom left. You can see it's marked CPU, VGA or PCIe, but we're going to plug CPU in down here. I do have the option to plug it in above on the top row, but I'm keeping everything related to the motherboard in the bottom left. I'm actually going to need two of these cables plugged in, and they're also split into two lots of four. So you can see that I have an 8-pin power supply unit cable at the top here that needs connecting. This is the top left of my motherboard. It may vary on yours, but I have one 8-pin and one 4-pin that need plugging in. And again, I'm demonstrating this outside of the case just because it's easier to show. As you'll see later on, it's a bit difficult to demonstrate when it's inside. But here I'm essentially got one cable, which is split into two parts, connected into one port. And then the other cable, only half of that cable I'm using for that other one because it's only a 4-pin. But you might find you have two 8-pins or just one 8-pin. It varies from motherboard to motherboard, but just make sure you plug those in. The next cable is the SATA power. So this goes in the top right somewhere, along with, you'll see, peripherals. So for example, fans and SATA drives, hard disk drives and SSDs are referred to as peripherals. So these are extra things that you're adding into your machine. Here's a Kingston drive. This is a small SSD, a 2.5 inch, and this requires flat SATA power connector, and then the other connection on it is for data cable to your motherboard. So you can see that you can only plug it in one way because it has like an L-shaped design of it, so there's a little notch on one end where it sort of sits up. So you can see me struggling to get it on here, but you can actually only plug it in one direction. So careful not to force it and make sure that you've got it the right way, and then you can plug it on, but you can't put it on the wrong way around, so don't fret too much. Now, as I said, there's multiple prongs on this cable, so it's worth bearing that in mind because you actually have the ability to connect multiple devices. Here I'm quickly demonstrating the other cable that you connect up. That cable connects there and then the other end to your motherboard, and that goes on the right hand side and gives you the data connection. But here you can see with daisy chains, we've got three extra cables still flopping around here. We could plug in extra drives, but just for demonstration purposes, I'm using one of Corsair's fan controllers. So this is a Commander Core, and you can connect up SATA flat power connectors to that as well. Connecting these up will then give you your control over the fans and fan power for your case if you're using one of these. And it will work with similar other controllers from other manufacturers as well. So essentially you can see that you might need flat SATA power connectors for multiple different things. Next one is the PCIe. So in the top left, you'll see it's marked VGA, PCIe and CPU. Again, this is a similar sort of connection, but PCIe is for your graphics card. So you plug in a graphics card there, and you may find you need multiples of these. I actually only need one, but I will demonstrate what you'd need if you'd need more, and obviously you plug them in the same place. I'd recommend plugging in all the cables before you build it in the case, and then you need to make sure that the PSU is facing downwards, so the fan faces to the bottom of the case if there's venting on it, where it will suck air from underneath the case into it to keep it cool, and then blow hot air out the rear, and that will obviously keep it running nicely. You then have four screws included in the box that you then screw into the small holes at the rear, securing the power supply unit into the case. You may find in some cases there's standoffs at the bottom of the case to put it into position and adjust it. But the important point of plugging the cables in beforehand is obviously you can see where the cables go. It makes life a lot easier in that. You also have a lot more flexibility in terms of the room, for example, for building, because you might find that some cases are quite restricted. This one actually has quite a lot of space for cabling at the rear, but some other cases are a bit less generous and can make it quite fiddly in terms of where the cables go. Now you can see that some of the holes look quite similar. There's some basically like hexagon shaped holes and then some standard round circles. So you need to look for the round circles, line those up with the various marks on the case itself, which you can see there's multiple. So there's actually like eight little extra bits that are jutting out that you could screw it into. So that obviously adjusts depending on what power supply you have. Now I'm running my two CPU power connections that go to the top of the motherboard, across the back of the case and up to the top. In this case, there are multiple hooks and loops for using the plastic cable ties to tie your cables down. I'd actually recommend not using those straight away and to use the Velcro ties instead. And the reason for this is you want to make sure that your cables are in the right place and that everything's working before you cable tie things down, because otherwise you're going to make life a bit more difficult for yourself at the end. So you can see me using those Velcro ties, tying everything up nicely and sort of hiding it away as much as possible. But you can see that it does sort of flop about, and there is still a big bit where it's not very nicely tied at the rear. Now you'll also notice that I'm plugging in those 8-pin CPU connectors again at the top left of the case, and this is actually a lot more fiddly now because the tower cooler that I've got installed is making it difficult to plug these in. So I'd actually recommend not installing your CPU cooler until you've plugged those cables in. That will make your life easier. But I wanted to just demonstrate that I also can't really show. This is why I showed it outside the case earlier on. This one, however, is easier. So this is the 24-pin connection that I showed earlier. And here you can see it's hidden behind a cable hiding tray. So you basically need to run that from the back of the case into the front. And again, you can only plug it in one way because it has a clip on one side, and that's how it plugs in. And once it's plugged in, it can be a bit fiddly to get out again, but you can do it. You just need to pull the clip first before you start pulling it. Once that's plugged in, you can see what I was talking about, though. These cables are individually sleeved, but they also don't come with any sort of teeth or anything to separate them. So you do need to sort of manipulate them a bit in order to make it look nice. I found I had to fiddle around with these quite a bit just to adjust where the position of each of the cables is and to make it look a bit nicer at the front. Some of the cable tidying, if you use those plastic cable ties at the rear to tighten things up, might make life a bit easier. Now for this build, I'm using a Founders Edition card, and as you can see, it has the PCIe adapter with it, and it only requires one cable, which I've run from the bottom. So you can see one of the PCIe cables that's split into two parts. So it has one connection that has 6 pins on it, and then there's two extras. So it's actually 8 pins in total. So you need to sort of squash these together and then force them into the adapter, which can be a fiddle to do, but they do connect on one side together and then they push in to the adapter in this GPU. And you can see me struggling to do it because it's not quite enough length in the cable there to get it through, but I'm trying to do it neatly here rather than running it through in a different position. And then again, it just clips over. So each of these cables just has a little hook that basically clips over to hold them in place depending on where you are installing them. Now, some graphics cards have a lot more. This graphics card is my RTX 3090 from Gigabyte, and you can see that actually has two lots of 8-pin connectors. Now, this is a different power supply unit, but the logic is the same, although there's no adapter here. You do need, obviously, extra cables. Now, as I said earlier, the cables that come with this power supply unit actually are looped into two connections per cable. So you could actually just use one cable still here, but you might find that you have a graphics card with three different power connectors on it or more, and so you might find you need to plug in two of those cables and then just repeat the process, plug them directly into the graphics card and you're away. Now we're all done and we can hide our cable shame at the back of the case by putting it down. Now I would recommend at this point, once you've turned it on, to make sure that it test runs and everything runs nicely that you then use the cable ties, the plastic cable ties, to tie everything down and neaten it up a bit. This is useful if you've got a case that is a bit less forgiving in terms of what you can do with the back, and it also ensures your airflow is a bit nicer, and also that you can make your front cables look a bit nicer as well. Hopefully this has been a useful insight into this power supply unit and how it works, but you can see once we've finished that it does actually look really nice, especially in this case, because most of the cables are barely visible, although I could tidy up that one on the top left, I suppose, a bit more by tugging it through to the back. But the end result is pretty nice. Now, this is the NZXT H510 Flow, along with a deep-cooled tower cooler and a number of other things. If you want to see more on that video and that case, check out the link in the description. This has been the Provoked Prawn. Thanks for watching.